Welcome once again, students, to the class of Investment Analysis. This is your faculty, Dr. Shweta Srivastav, Associate Professor, School of Management, BBDO University. Students, hope all of you are doing good. So, students, today I am taking up the topic Investment Pattern of Average Household in India. See, before I start this lecture, I want to tell you few things which are embedded in our Indian culture, because we should understand that savings is the integral part of our Indian culture. We have seen the couplets like Sai itna dijiye jaame kutum samaye, prab main bhi bhookha na rahu sadhu na bhookha jaye. We have studied you can say sayings like santosham param sukham. See, with these types of pillars in our Indian culture, savings and investment is integral part of our daily lives. Students, you have to understand that the money which you are utilizing in your education is not actually the money which is earned today. Basically, the preparations were started since the day you were born. So this is what we call Indian practices, right? So, but with the passage of time, the pattern has changed. No doubt, we Indians are good in saving our money. We do not prefer or allow wastages in our lives. So saving is the integral part of our life, but how we are saving, on what avenues we are saving, what options we are utilizing to make our money grow, that has changed with the passage of time because of globalization, because of technology, because of so many changes in the legal structure, because of so many changes in the political framework. So these changes have actually impacted our investment pattern, but the one thing remains same, that is the habit of saving and investment in our daily life. So students, let us start. Now, see, household saving corresponds to the total income saved by households during a certain period of time. See, every household has a monthly income. After dealing with our all kinds of expenditures, what is left in our hands is our savings. So this is the household savings, and after employing the inflationary factor, what is left is the real saving, right? So instead of keeping that money in our almira, in our lockers, what we do, generally we invest it in the market. See, in the first unit, you have already understood the process of financial intermediation, right? It is basically the banks and other financial institutions or the broking agencies which are channelizing the money from the persons who have and the persons who need. So who have the savings? The general person. A common man has the saving, but at the same time he wants to grow his or her money. So what he is supposed to do? He is supposed to invest in the market so that investment can combat or compensate the inflationary pressure, plus it grows so as to meet the investment objective, right? So basically, whatever saving a common man is generating or doing, that my saving is channelized or flown into the market, which we want to say the industry, right? So this creates capital. So savings leads to investment, and investment leads to creation of capital. So this sets the economy into rotation. Because whatever capital I am investing in the market, that will be used for expansion of industries, for creation of employment, and more of employment is generated, more of consumption is done. So this basically sets the economy into rotation. So whatever capital we are putting in, that can be used by the same person, right? If I am giving, employing in, say, I am buying a debenture or a share. So that capital is used by, say, I am taking example of Tata. So if I have bought one scrip of Tata, that is, that money is used by the Tata company, right? But after some time, what will happen? When I'll resell my share, that capital will again come back to me with an appreciation, and that will be used by me. That is the same person, right? So this capital can be used by the same person who has accumulated and created it, or it can be hired or lent to others in the name of FD, that we are lending it to our banks. It can be given to the companies in the name of debentures, that it can be given to corporates in the name of shares. So that capital can be used by the same person or by the companies or the government and the banks and other parties, right? So we have seen that no doubt saving is our daily practice, and you can say the practice which is embedded in our Indian culture. But see, the preference has changed with the times, right? Because the social setup is changing. In the previous days, we have large families, we have so many children, but now this is the time of dual income, sometimes no kids, what we call in the language of marketing dinks, right? So these are the times of nuclear families. So you can say the people are more cautious about saving, more cautious about investments, because they are taking care of their own family. They don't have the support of their extended family members, right? The family is divided. So in these times, the people are more concentrated on investing in the industry so that they can have proper return. Secondly, what is happening in the case of demographic changes? What is happening? The percentage of young age to the old age people in India, this percentage is high. Like, our population is more composed of young people and less of old age people. So that is why we are finding it that the financial market is on the growth stage, because these old age people were generally conservative and risk averses. So if I look at my father, he had never invested in share markets. He had never invested in equity. But what I am doing right now, I am investing in equity, I am investing in mutual funds also. So because I am belong to a sort of new generation, and I am, you can see my risk appetite is higher than as my father. So my father used to invest in FDs, my father used to invest in NSC, National Savings Certificates and all, and Kisan Vikas Patra like instruments. So there is a change in the demographic composition also. The economic scenario has changed altogether. We have seen this is the time of multinational companies, this is the time of foreign exchange regulations. These are the times of, you can say, technological advancements. These are the times when the SEBI and RBI are actually playing a very good role in protecting the interest of the investors. The crude oil prices are decreasing. You can say this is the time of globalized world. So you are exposed to economic, you can say, globalized threats also. So there are so many things changing right now. So that is why we are seeing there is a drastic shift in the investment patterns, right? Which we'll be studying in the forthcoming slides. There is a change in the legal environment also. See, gone were the days when the India was following the policy of protectionism. In the year 1977, we have the closed economy till 1991. In the year 1991, our foreign exchange reserves were depleted up to such a level that we had only 1 week of reserve to serve our purposes, right? The first thing. Second, we had pressures from WTO. Because of that, it was imperative, that was required to open up the geographical boundaries, right? So this, you can say, liberalization took place in two platforms, one internal in the name of privatization, external in the name of globalization, right? So this has changed the legal environment. Now we have legal structures which are compatible to other global scenario like GST. There is a change in the legal environment because of Foreign Exchange Regulation Act. There is a change in the legal environment because of FDIs, increasing inflow of FDIs. So our focus is on developing an environment which is investment friendly. So that is why the entire ecosystem is changing. So since the entire ecosystem is changing, we are seeing a substantial change in the investment pattern which is assumed by a common Indian man. So let us understand how it took place and how the preference has changed with the changes in these four parameters: social, demographic, economic and legal. Now let us understand the pattern. From 1992 to 2000, Indian households preferred to invest in financial assets as compared to physical assets. Now students, I hope by this time you are conversant about what are financial assets and what are physical assets. But I'm again giving you a brief view. Financial assets like LICs, like mutual funds, like shares, like debentures, like FDs, like PPFs. These are all your financial assets, right? Physical assets means you are buying out, you are investing in real estate, you are buying in gold, precious metals. These are your physical assets. Buying a flat, buying a land, buying 10 grams of gold or silver or platinum. These are all your physical assets. So till 2000, people prefer to invest in financial assets. Financial assets mean generally people prefer to invest in FDs. That I used to tell you that what my father did. So he invested more in FDs and PPFs and NSEs and all, and bought gold less because the prices of gold were very less at that times. So the return on investment is more as in case of financial assets. So, and moreover, that was the time of liberalization. More and more companies were coming, so there was a height of consumption pattern. So industries were growing at that time. So at that time, investing in financial assets was advisable. Now coming to the year after 2000, what happened after 2000? There was a rise in the real estate industry. Right. So from 2000 to 2007, the more savings were routed to physical assets because people realized that now, since they have invested enough money in the financial assets, now they wanted to buy a house. Now they wanted to have a piece of land. Right. So the preference shifted to physical assets. Right. So between the year 2000 to 2007, the savings were shifted to physical assets like buying out gold, because at that time, if you remember, the price of gold is seeing an upsurge. So people, when you have a feeling of rising prices, what you do? You prepone your purchases. So more of purchases were done for gold, for land and for house, right? So the preference was of physical assets. But what happened in the year 2007 and 2008? That was basically, we are at a crossroads. So in the year 2007 and 8, the most of the investment was made in financial assets. But what happened in the year 2008? The market crashed because of recession in the American economy. We all know that in the year 2000 and 2008, retail and small investors participated in the stock markets because their valuations were at peak. But what happened in the year 2008? See, in the same years in America, the real estate industry was at boom. So because of ripple effect, that came to India also. That is why people started buying physical assets, right? But since because of this real estate industry boom, that bubble crashed because of the crash of Lehman Brothers, the bank, right? What happened in America? There were more of a subprime lending to just boost this real estate industry. But because of high supply and lesser demand, the market of real estate industry crashed. Since the market of real estate industry crashed in America, the Lehman Brothers, which was, you can say, which has lent the money most in America, that bank crashed, right? So because of, again, the globalization, that effect came to India also. So from 2008 till 2015, Indians preferred physical savings as compared to financial savings. Because you can say the feeling of once bitten, twice shy, like people generally shift in investing in financial markets, seeing the trend in American economy, right? So the more of the money went to real estate industry majorly because there was a little bit of a stagnation in prices coming in gold also. So people invested more in real estate industry. The price of land and houses was touching the sky. So there was exorbitant price rise in the real estate industry, high level of corruption, high level of money laundering practices, high level of black money circulating, right? So when BJP came into reign, they came up with a new act, that is RERA, that is Real Estate and Regulation Act. So that again, you can say, transform the entire economy. Then now the people are more shifted to this financial instruments, because now it is very difficult to channelize your black money, or you can say illicit money, in the real estate, right? So now let us see how the movement took place. So gross financial saving in the year 2014 till 2018, they are continuously rising. Right, you can say we are at somewhere around 18,800 billion were invested in financial assets. So savings are rising, right? But what is happening to physical assets? So the savings in the physical assets are gradually decreasing, only because of one factor, that is your RERA. Like, because RERA has actually stifled the money which was exorbitantly flowing in the real estate industry. You have seen the land mafias, you have seen people, you can say, extortion in the name of land, and so many big builders were coming up. Only they were, you can say, exploiting a common man, and the prices of houses and prices of land were seeing very, you can say, are on the upsurge. So, because of these factors, RERA was finally thrown into the market, and you can see the money is gradually reducing for physical assets, right? So, the more of money is now flowing into financial assets. Now came, you can say, the year of demonetization. Like, see, now this is the general trend. Right. So in the year 2012 and 13 until 2017 and 18, we are seeing that there is a gradual change. You can say the graph grows up, graph goes down. But see what is happening in the 2017 and 18. This is the time of demonetization. Right. So people have stopped investing in banks. Okay. Now coming to non-banking deposits. Now non-banking deposits are seeing sometime, generally you can say for normal trend, no heights, no lows. General smooth curve is following in case of non-banking deposits. Now coming to life insurance funds. See the type of uncertainty we are facing in our lives, the increased number of accidents, increased number of diseases has actually increasing the need of life insurance, right? So life insurance fund is increasing. See, till now there is only 6 to 7% of percolation of life insurance in our Indian citizens. So life insurance fund is continuously seeing an increase, right? Now coming to provident and pension funds. See, it is again on the growth side because of this is a safe instrument. So everybody is trying to secure future. So we are having and moreover, this PPF is your own fund. It can only be utilized by you or your nominees. It cannot be utilized by anybody else. So you have a high degree of security in case of PPF. Moreover, the interest rates are okay in case of PPF. So money is also flowing in PPFs. Now coming to shares and debentures. Now see the rise. See the rise in case of shares and debentures. There is a high rise of the money in flowing into these financial instruments. Now why this is happening? This is happening because there is a drastic change in the legal structure of our country. SEBI and RBI are strengthened so much that now they are in a position to protect the interest of a common man. How the interest of the common man is protected? Because now they are coming up with stringent norms. Now you have every company has to follow those rules and regulations. Now the we have strict IFRS regulations. This means international financial accounting standards, which were we were only following GAAP, but till 2009 every company needs to employ international financial reporting standards. So these IFRS are transparent. These IFRS are, you can say, global friendly, and the accountants throughout the world are speaking the same language. So it is easier to decipher which company is doing good or which company is doing bad. So now the investors are in a position to analyze whether to invest in that company or not. In the bygone days, the things were not that much transparent. So now people have started relying on the financial market. SEBI has actually organizing so many investment awareness programs in the name of IAP. So many advisors are there so as to let you know how to grow your money, how to compensate for inflationary trend, how to utilize the market trend, how to utilize the market phenomena so that your money grows and you can meet your investment objective. So you are continuously seeing that is a rising trend in case of shares and debentures, right? So this is the time of mutual funds. See, after demonetization, what happened? We understood that it is not right to keep money in your lockers, in your home, right? In the same way, the rate of interest on FDs is deteriorating. Right now, you are a common man is only 6.5% of interest. Right, previously it was close to 9 or 10%. In case of senior citizen, you have one more percent, that is 7.5%. So this rate of interest and the rate of inflation is close to 8%. So that FD is not compensating your inflationary trend. You are still at loss. Sometimes the inflation goes to 6.5 or 7, again you are at the break even. So these FDs and PPFs are no more a lucrative proposition for a common man. So where he means now the a common man is left with only one thing, that is mutual fund, right? So these mutual fund companies are managed by asset management companies. Now we have to understand what is the difference between mutual fund and a pure equity. See, basically mutual fund is a fund, right? This fund is composed of different companies which are not correlated. Correlated means, students, you have understood this thing in unit 1, that is what is correlation index. See, correlation index indicates how far the industries are correlated or interdependent on each other. Because if a company suffers loss, that effect will go to complementary industries or complementary companies also. So investors try to deploy their funds in those companies which are not correlated. So these mutual funds are created with this by following this principle also. And the second principle, do not put all the eggs in one basket. So mutual fund is basically a fund of diversified companies and industries so that internal hedging can be done. If one industry faces loss, another industry is there to compensate with its increment, right? So this is how a mutual fund is created. After demonetization, you have seen the ads of mutual funds. We have not seen it prior to that. So after demonetization, it was understood that it is not advisable to keep cash in your accounts. Liquidity matters. That is why we have so many liquid funds from which you can retrieve money in just 3 days' time. So lot of things are happening in the financial markets. The regulatory bodies are being strengthened. The newer and newer instruments are being created. There is a lot of transparency in the transactions. SEBI is, tightening its clutches. So all such things are happening, and that is why a common man is showing its trust and or confidence in the financial market. So that is what is being manifested in this slide, that and the things are moving in the same pattern. So there is a rise in the investment in case of shares, debentures and mutual funds also. So now what are the key takeaways from the last 5, 6, 7 years, right? See, in the year 1920, in the year 1920 is an exceptional year. We are suffering from COVID. So I think this should be taken as an exceptional year while understanding the pattern in the pattern of Indian investment, right? Because nowadays the entire shift is on essential goods or on health equipments, because we are scared of from the impact of COVID. The purchase pattern or the purchase preference has altogether changed. We are focusing on health plans so that we can meet up with the expenses of our health. We are focusing on medical. We are more expending on medical or the things which are building our immunity. So the entire shift is only because of COVID, and this is an exceptional year, so we should not take into consideration this year, right? But seeing the last 5-7 years, we should understand that we Indians maintain a reasonably high percentage of net savings as compared to our GDP. Now the net saving rate as a percentage of GDP has been steadily declining since 11-12 because of high inflationary patterns, right? Moreover, there is a change in the global scenario also, because there is a change in, you can say, we have seen the China American turf. We have now seen the Indo-China turf. So because of this, what is happening? The GDP is not growing as expected. So that is why the net savings rate as percentage of GDP has been steadily declining. But we have to understand that a major portion of these savings is still invested in gold and low yielding bank fixed deposits, because people are actually skeptical in investing in financial market because of these seeing the patterns in the globalized world, in America, in China. So people are still investing in, yet the percentage is low. But if we see, because we know that a large chunk of Indian population is composed of a rural person, or you can say the suburban areas. So they still have faith in gold, they still have faith in FD, or they still have faith in LIC like companies. So we are seeing that there is a rise in the investment in financial markets, but still the percentage is not that much high. The households borrowing are more in the name of car, in the name of education loan, in the name of, you can say, gold loan and all. So households borrowings are more. Government is also trying to put in as much of money in the industry. So banks are lending at a cheaper rates. So households borrowings are more. But it is true that most of the households are still devoid of that formal financial system. The reason being, the Indian population, the 60% of the Indian population is residing in the nook and corners of the country. So Indian government is actually trying hard to bring that unprivileged population to this formal financial system. More and more of rural branches are coming up so that they can be put into the mainstream. Once they are put into the mainstream, we will see the growth in the Indian economy. So as far as an individual is concerned, there should be a healthy mix of financial assets and physical assets, right? We know that the basic rule of finance, that you should not put all the eggs in one basket. Every asset has its own prospects and consequences. So instead of relying on one asset we should diversify, we should distribute our total saving, we should create a portfolio in such a way that it should have, you can say, internal hedging at one point of time and should be able to meet our investment objective, should have proper risk coverage, should have proper liquidity and should have proper capability to meet our investment objectives. So with these types of frameworks, we should try to create our portfolio in the name of financial asset and physical asset. But students, you have to understand that whatever money you are saving, it should be flown to financial market, because it is the financial market which is playing a role of an intermediary for industries, in the name of, between industry and the common man. When this money is flown to the industries, what will happen? This will set the economy into rotation and there will be equitable distribution of income, which is, you can say, the prime objective of our Indian government. So students, what are the key takeaways? The investment pattern is changing with the passage of time. Now people are more focused on financial market. I mean to say urban people. Rural people are still relying on gold and FDs and LICs. We are borrowing more in the name of car, households and all, right? We should try to prepare, create an optimum portfolio of financial and physical assets, and we should understand that giving money to financial market is essential for the growth of a country. So students, this is all for today. We'll meet again with the next topic. Thank you.